seriously welcome here. If you're like, you're recently to Riga, if you're a student, a Rasmus student or whatever, and you know, if you haven't figured everything out in living in Latvia, just, you know, there's a lot of people here who can help. So please ask for help. I mean, there's other students, there's other people who are here for a couple of years and they've had to figure out what you're figuring out. There's a lot of local people who have figured everything out from birth, and then there's some of us who have been here a long, long time and maybe haven't figured things out. But the point is, there's lots of help here in this community, so just seriously feel free to ask. If you're trying to figure some things out, there are people here who can help, so take advantage of those resources. Well, we are now kind of coming to the last piece of a long journey we've been on since October. Last October, we started a long series, and we started with this verse, and this has kind of been our key verse throughout this series. We are God's masterwork, or work of art. And as Paul wrote it originally, the emphasis is on God. God's work of art, we are. We are created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. So we spent a couple weeks looking just at that verse, and then just kind of unpacking it, and I was making the point that, you know, God is an artist, and we have been created uniquely, individually, and these good works are not just generic good works that are true for all Christians, or it includes that, but each of you have been created uniquely to contribute in a special way, in ways that no one else can contribute. And from there, then, we've spent a lot of time looking in the Old Testament, the creation story, to figure out how it is that God uses people, why were they created, and how he is using them. And then now, this last part of the journey, we're going to be talking about spiritual gifts, but it's still about, you know, how we contribute to what God is doing. So just to kind of summarize where we have been, we've seen that God is a master designer. If you look at creation, you know, it is just amazingly designed for life. You know, for life to exist, a lot of things have to fit together in a very well-tuned way, and that's the universe that we live in. You know, not only functional like an engineer, but it's beautiful, artistic. And so therefore, we should expect creativity, variety, and diversity. You know, that variety and diversity has been built in as part of God's good gift. I mean, right now, you know, Tanya's pointed out just four kinds of food. You know, but that's, you know, four kinds of food is almost nothing in comparison to the thousands and thousands of different kinds of foods that God has made available. The variety that God provides. And then the diversity, you know, of trees, how many different species of trees and plants, and then the diversity of humanity. That's what God wanted, the differences God wanted. It was part of his design. Now, how that relates to us is through the Imago Dei, the image of God. Every human is created in God's image. God has put something of himself into all humans. Every human, equally, is in the image of God. And we are to reflect God, image out God, through how we behave in the world. God is a model for us, and the image of God is about function, about a role. We are created to contribute. But of course, sin entered the picture, and so now we can talk more about recreation. So in this verse, we could say, we are God's masterwork, recreated in Christ Jesus. And it's important to remember that, because even as much as we have marred or bent or twisted what God did, that doesn't limit God. God is still the master worker, and he can recreate us in beautiful ways. And so again, we are diversely designed individuals for individual contribution. So we are different. That's a good thing. And throughout this series, I've I've tended to emphasize more, you know, our individuality, our uniqueness, and that we are individuals, we are different, the differences are good. And I've done that intentionally, but of course there's always a danger, especially in the Western world, for those of us who are from the more from the Western, and then America's an even further extreme where we almost make an idol of individualism or independence. You know, and so independence is the highest value. And as I pointed out before, you know, for Americans, you know, one of our, you know, great heroes said, give me liberty or give me death. You know, liberty is more important than even life. And there's a reason why that was said then, but there's a danger of making that the absolute good. You know, that the most important thing is me and my independence, and I'm putting myself in the center of my universe, maybe myself in the center of the universe. And so while we need to affirm the importance of each of us as individuals, as we're thinking about spiritual gifts, or how we are created, we need to always go back to the truth that we are individuals, but not independent. Independence is not as big a concern to God as it might be to us. So this entire process, you know, this person that we're becoming, we need to always remind ourselves that it is God initiated. I'm not figuring out who I want to be. I'm not creating myself. No one does that, really. You know, the idea you can be whoever you want to be, that's never true. You know, we're all born certain ways. You know, there was never a chance that I would be a great mathematician. Never a chance. I could never do that. I could never have been probably a great American football player. I'm not built for it. There was zero chance that I could be that. There's lots of other things I might be, but we can't just make ourselves whatever we want to be. Okay, and so what I've been talking about is what it is that God is doing. This whole thing is God initiated, and it's Christ-centered. So one of the reasons we did the Apostles' Creed today is to remind us that we are not really independent. We can't create our own faith. You know, at least here, we're not creating our own religion. We who are followers of Jesus, who might call ourselves Christians, it is a received faith. And I don't tell Jesus who he is. And so the Apostles' Creed is mainly about Jesus. He is the center of the universe. Okay? Not me. And I don't get to tell him who he is or what he is doing. Okay, so our faith, you know, actually needs to be focused on that, and that's what brings us together. So we are individuals, but not independent. It's all God initiated and Christ-centered. And so today, for a few minutes, as we're going to begin to think about spiritual gifts, today's emphasis is not on the particularity or the variety or the diversity, but it's more on the unity. Because we always need to go back to that we're actually, however different we are, we are part of a community. And that requires certain things of us. Even our God-given abilities and our God-given gifts doesn't mean now I have this and I can use it however I want. We're a part of a community. I found a quote this last week, and I won't get into the context of it, but it was an interesting reminder. Here it was an Old Testament scholar just talking about the place of the law, the Mosaic law, and how, you know, that wasn't a law that was necessarily given to all people equally. It was given particularly to Israel for a particular purpose. And so this particular Old Testament scholar said this: Israel's purpose is not to create converts. It is to create something that people might potentially be able to convert to. Namely, a people and a nation that God is with. And scholars often debate what how the Jewish people were meant to live out their role. Were they supposed to run around, you know, the world and evangelize and create converts? Or primarily for them, were they simply to live as the people of God? And living as the people of God, people would see that and think, wow, that's kind of different. That's, I don't get that, but there's something interesting about that. Now, I'm not absolutizing this statement, and now as the church, we're the people of God, and I do think part of our purpose is to create converts. But again, the danger is then we just run around and we're, you know, grabbing this person and this person, we're evangelizing out there. And I do think you, all of you who are followers of Jesus, do have a responsibility for the people in your world. But once again, there's this community element to this that we need to take seriously. I mean, you know, I don't necessarily think the best way for you to evangelize is to invite people here to church on Sunday morning. You know, but, you know, I think your first step is invite people to your home, invite people out to coffee, you know, develop that relationship. But at the same time, I'm conscious of the importance of a community like this, that we ought to be a community that you could invite people to. And that too will help attract people to Jesus. See, one of the things that sometimes happens is you might meet someone, they find out you're a Christian and they like you, and you get together, and people think most of those Christians are just weird and bad people, and you're just, you know, out of 1,000 bad Christians, you're the one good Christian, and wow, I'm kind of glad I met you. You know, but the rest of those Christians out there are just kind of freaks. That's not exactly true. I mean, I hopefully you're just really a great person and a great Christian, but, you know, what people do need to experience is, you know, there's actually a lot of other Christians out there who are not the best people in the world, but they're not the worst either. And what people do need to experience is God's power to create community. And I think this is one of the beautiful things about an international church with all our differences. For those of you who have, grown up in church or had a lot of church experience, you might know that almost every church has one or two people that the church is kind of a little bit embarrassed about. You know, some that other people in the church think is kind of weird or an oddball or, you know, I hope this serves. That's really not a bad thing. You know, the fact that a church is a community that will welcome weird people and oddballs, that's a good thing. But, you know, here's the thing. You know, we might be a church full of weird people and oddballs and people who are like different and have interesting little views about that, and each one of us as an individual might be weird, or a little bit weird, or a lot weird. But when a bunch of oddballs get together in a community, that's actually pretty amazing. And I think people recognize that. All those weird people, but when they're together, that's a pretty cool thing. You know, I could well imagine, you know, some people thinking, I don't really want to spend a lot of time with Mark Sandberg alone. But Mark Sandberg in a group, it's not so bad. Honestly, I could well imagine that being the case. That might be the case for some of you too. That it's actually the community that uniquely brings people in. And in one sense, the more odd the people are in the community, the more it shows that, man, this is not just a human-generated community. Maybe there's something supernatural going on here. And wouldn't it be cool to be a part of that kind of community? And so today I just want us to keep thinking about the importance of community, even though we're going to go back to thinking, you know, about our unique role. The two texts I want to look at quickly as we just begin to think about, you know, the next few weeks talking about spiritual gifts. And one text that kind of introduces talk about spiritual gifts is in Ephesians chapter 4. And there Paul says, "Therefore I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you, urge you, to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called." Everything that was written in the first three chapters, this incredible identity that we have been given in Jesus Christ, now walk worthy of that, with all humility and gentleness. In New Testament times, humility was not seen as a virtue. I mean, literally, some philosophers put that on kind of a bad list. Don't be characterized by humility. Don't make yourself a slave. And so in the New Testament, when humility, you know, was this word that was used, was put down as a positive thing, that was incredibly countercultural in the early church. So with humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love. Here, you know, patience in this context is probably not, you know, patience at a restaurant waiting for your food, or patience in line. You know, if some of you are having to get documents or whatever, I don't know if you're waiting many, many hours in line, you know, that requires patience. You know, dealing with government officials. By the way, I think it's a lot better now than it used to be. I mean, people have been here a long time in Latvia can probably give you stories of, you know, trying to get residence permits, and those were some horror stories. It's a lot better now, but it requires patience. But here, patience is about people. You know, waiting for people to develop and learn and grow, and forbearing or putting up, tolerating with a lot of stuff that you might not like ideally, you know. Anytime a group gets together, you gotta tolerate people. You gotta tolerate a sermon. Some people like sermons, some people don't. Some people maybe respond to my style. I'm quite certain that other people, my style is not their ideal, you know. But you just maybe have to tolerate it. So some of you might look at your watch and you're waiting to go get that food. Well, you'll get there, but you gotta tolerate me for a few minutes. Well, actually, you don't. You're welcome to go get some food while I'm talking, but I'm not stopping. Showing tolerance for one another in love and being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as also you are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. So Paul gives kind of these seven ones. One Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and there's one hope. One Lord, Jesus Christ, and one faith and one baptism, and over all of that is the Father, God the Father. So again, this is why we set the Apostles' Creed. The Apostles' Creed is just kind of an expanded statement of what was written here, you know, the center of our faith, based on God and what God is doing, especially with Jesus Christ in the center of that. So if we can get that right, then we can rightfully use verse 7. But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. And in coming weeks, I'll talk about that, each one. You know, everyone who's part of the body of Christ is given a gift. Everyone can contribute. I mean, that's just an amazing thing. Everyone gets to contribute. Everyone gets to contribute. Everyone. But it's a gift. And it's measured out primarily by how Christ wants to measure it out, not primarily based on any merit or worth that we bring to the table. Earlier, Paul had written similarly to the Corinthian church, and we're going to spend a good bit of time in some chapters in 1 Corinthians. But he says, now there are varieties of gifts. Of course there are. That's the way God is. You know, creative. But it's the same Spirit who gives the gifts. And there are varieties of ministries, but it's the same Lord, Jesus, who in the church takes people with these gifts and puts those people in the ministries where he wants them to be. Planned and designed and arranged ideally. People with gifts who are then placed in the right slots. And then there are varieties of effects, but it's the same God who works all things in all. And so, you know, God has determined that certain people will have this effect, another effect. So there might be two evangelists, and one is Billy Graham. And God has determined for Billy Graham that he might have, you know, thousands and thousands of converts. That's God's gift to Billy Graham, not Billy Graham's gift to God. But there might be another evangelist who's also, it's a God-given gift. And in God's plan, it's okay for God that this other evangelist doesn't have Billy Graham's effects. God has certain effects for this guy, and it's different, and it's okay. And this guy doesn't have to compare himself to Billy Graham or someone else, because he can be content that it's God who wants to work certain effects. But then to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. So here again, as Paul begins to talk a lot about spiritual gifts in the next three chapters, this is how he introduces it with the unity. It's the same Spirit, the same Lord Jesus Christ, the same Father God who is working this. And then out of that unity, then comes the diversity. To each one is given a particular manifestation of the Spirit. So here's two people. Here's us. And here, I put in the title, spiritual gifts. Because often when, you know, in the church we talk about these gifts, they're called spiritual gifts. In Corinthians, when Paul talks about these gifts, there's two different words he uses for it. And one is the word that is built on the Greek word for spirit. So that's one of the words Paul uses, and it is probable that Paul uses that word sometimes because that's the word the Corinthian church likes. When they talk about their gifts, they like this word based on the Spirit. It's, I've got the Spirit. I've got this great spiritual life in me. And so their preferred word is to emphasize the Spirit that they have, that they've attained a certain level of experience of the Spirit. So Paul uses that word very possibly because that's the preferred word of the Corinthian church. But it seems like Paul prefers a different word when he talks about these spiritual gifts, and it's a word that is built on the Greek word grace, charis. It's where we get the word charismatic, where the emphasis is supposed to be on grace. And so Paul prefers to talk about grace gifts. These are gifts that God gives by grace. They are gifts, and we need to emphasize the gift nature of it. Now, one of the questions that comes up when people talk about spiritual gifts is, what is the relationship between spiritual gifts and like natural talents or abilities? Or whatever. And some really good thinkers like to make a strong separation between spiritual gifts and then, you know, whatever comes by nature from our upbringing, from experience, from our DNA. There's those kinds of talents that we might be born with, you know, but different from those are spiritual gifts or grace gifts. So some people like to separate those two very strongly. And, you know, they might have good reasons for that. For myself, my tendency is to not think of a strong separation between a spiritual gift and what might be a natural talent. Now, one of the reasons I suggest that is, you know, with a natural talent, we might be born with something, but you still have to develop it. Okay? It improves with practice. My mom is an artist, and I think I have in me, in my DNA, some artistic ability, but that never developed. You know, the direction of my life went a different way, and so that was something that might have been built into me, but I'm not an artist. I wouldn't call myself an artist by any stretch of the imagination, because I didn't develop that, although maybe I could have. But any kind of natural talent, you ought to practice and improve. But I think myself, that can be true of spiritual gifts. Even though they're given by God, through use and practice, those too can be improved. That is, you have a role to play in that. And so that's one of the reasons why I think there's, you know, there's more of a natural relationship between our natural gifts and spiritual gifts. But the main thing I want to emphasize today is that another reason I don't make a strong separation is because the truth is we need to see simply all of life as God-given. And as gifts of grace. Even what seems to be by nature, it's not like God was uninvolved in that. You know, I mean, a lot of what I do, you know, I think it's because of my family. My two brothers are pastors. I've said this before. My sister is married to a pastor. We're teachers. My parents were teachers. You know, we're all teachers. You know, all of us, about the only thing we can do in this world is run our mouths. You know, my one brother, he's a good mechanic. He can do other things. But most of us, all we can do is talk. You know, so that's, you know, so that, I can say it's, yeah, well, that's a natural talent or whatever. But the point is, that was God. God was involved in who my parents were and what experience I was given to develop that. In all of life, God was involved in it. It's all a gift. Okay, it's grace is involved in all of life. And so there's really no way to separate some part of life and to think, oh, this was mainly God. And if we say that's mainly God, what are we saying? This is mainly me? It's not mainly me. I'm not saying it's not me. If it were all of God, it would be a lot better. You know, it is me, and my choices are important. I've got to cooperate with what God is doing. But the point is, God is involved in all of it, and apart from God, none of it would work. None of it would work. So again, for now, I want us to emphasize that our uniqueness is, suddenly I have this idea that our uniqueness is not unique, in a sense, if you know what I'm saying, in that what is common for all of our uniqueness is that it comes from God. It has a source that is outside of ourselves. So just to summarize very quickly, and this is one of the things I'm going to unpack in the coming weeks, is that these gifts are given for a purpose. And so we need to be more and more clear what the purpose is. What is it that God is doing? And why is he given these gifts to lead to that? And then I'm going to be emphasizing diversity, the importance of diversity. And one of the problems that sometimes comes in the church when they talk about spiritual gifts is some people want to make everyone conform to certain gifts, as if to say everyone ought to have this gift. And if you don't have this gift, there's something wrong with you. And just to lay my cards on the table, and I'll prove it later, that is not true. That is not true. When it comes to gifts, God is into diversity. Not everyone having to conform in one way or another to one or two. But in that diversity, we always need to remind ourselves that diversity has to operate within a unity. There's a wider unity that we always have to remember, and if we are using our gifts, our uniqueness, to destroy the body or split the body or to hurt people, then we're missing the point. And so the key words for us now is humility and unity. And once again, I just want to remind us that humility is always a virtue. Pride is always a sin. Pride is always bad. And you know, I've talked before about how we often, you know, make a hierarchy of sins, and at different times, you know, people put this particular sin as kind of the worst sin possible, you know, and all, you know, often they're related to sexual sins. So those are, if you can avoid the big sexual sins, then it's not so bad. You know, I mean, when I was young, you know, the biggie was divorce. You know, that's like the unforgivable sin. You can be guilty of anything, you know, but not divorce. And then now that it's other things. But I think biblically speaking, you know, the biggie is pride. And it's a good reminder of that, I think, because I think that's something we're often tempted towards. This is a danger for all of us. And when we make a sin list and we pick the sins that someone else has, oh, that person is guilty of this really bad one. That person is guilty of this, that really bad one. And I'm not that person. I'm not guilty of those bad ones. No, you're guilty of the worst one. Right now. Pride. So we need to constantly come back to pride and unity, or to humility and unity. So with that, this sermon has really been an introduction to what's coming up, to throw out some ideas, but a lot of this, I hope if you are able to come back, you know, this will kind of be fleshed out and make sense. If you're not back, I hope at least something here you can kind of hold on to and be worth considering this week. To finish our service today, I'm going to invite Becky up, and she's going to lead us in a time of prayer that that really fits the theme in this Baltic 100 initiative. We're praying for the Baltic states for 100 days, and today's week is church. So, Becky.